Today's message is going to build on Pastor Tom's last message. So I hope you hear me. You're hearing me, Pastor Tom, that's what we're going to talk about. That last message was, where are you, God? And so today we're going to learn a little bit about where God is. So I'm going to go through some historical, biblically historical things today, because I'm not sure everybody has followed the whole narrative. But after Yeshua rose from the dead, he rose on the appointed time, the Moad, of first fruits, which, as I mentioned earlier, the Sunday during the week of Passover and unleavened bread. And we pick up the account in Acts chapter 1 and verse 3. During a period of 40 days, they saw him, and he spoke with them about the kingdom of God. Now, we have to understand that Yeshua was in his resurrected body during this time. As you read through the accounts in the New Covenant, his disciples had trouble recognizing him until he revealed himself spiritually. He had still had his wounds in that body. The body passed through walls, and he ate food. So all kinds of mysteries there. Verse 4, at one of these gatherings, he instructed them not to leave Jerusalem or Jerusalem, but to wait for, quote, what the Father promised, which you heard about from me. So understand here that his disciples were Galileans, and they were not to go home. They were to wait in Jerusalem, as he instructed them. Verse 5, for Yochanan or John used to immerse people in water, but in a few days you will be immersed in the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. And as you are most aware, that the Ruach came 10 days after this 40th day that he was with them on the 50th day. And as I was praying about, well, you know, why that day? Well, the 50th day is the day, according to the rabbis, and I believe they're right, that although it doesn't say it explicitly in the Bible, that it was the 50th day after they got out of Egypt that the Israelites came to Mount Sinai, and God appeared on Mount Sinai and gave them the Ten Commandments. So God always has this amazing timing. And now he was saying that the promise of the Father is going to be poured out on the same day the Ten Commandments were given. And in my mind, that really, really inspires a very quick equation, which is that we need the Word, the Ten Commandments, and we need the Spirit. And you can't understand the Word without the Spirit, and you can't follow the leading of the Spirit without the Word. So they both came on the same day, because the Ten Commandments were the beginning of the Bible. So in 10 days, that was going to happen from the 40th day. In verse 6, so when they gathered together, they asked him, Lord, are you restoring the kingdom to Israel at this time? Remember, Israel was under the occupation of the Romans at this time, and here we see how clueless the disciples were. They had no idea what was about to happen. They were still hoping for him to lead a revolution and an army. And having seen him do miracles, well, you can just wipe out the Romans and we can have the kingdom back as part of Israel. But that wasn't what happened. In verse 7, he said to them, it is not your place to know the times or the seasons which the Father has placed under his own control. In verse 8, but you will receive power when the Ruach HaKodesh has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and through all Judah and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So here he's telling them more clearly that something special is going to happen, and it's going to be power, and they are going to receive a commission also. They're going to be commissioned to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth. And then in verse 9, it says, after saying all this, while they were watching, he was taken up and a cloud received him out of their sight. So he ascended on the 40th day of the Omer. Anybody know when the 40th day would be? If you just do a little bit of arithmetic with the calendar. Thursday. So Thursday is the 40th day. And I'm sure his disciples were remembering, because they were counting the Omer every day. So they would have remembered that. And I wanted to help get everybody to see here, because it's not normally thought of this way, but the 40th day is a moad, an appointed time of God. It was the time that he appointed for the Lord to rise and be taken up in the clouds and no longer be present in his glorified body in the world. So it was another sign of his deity that he would rise up in the clouds in this amazing way and disappear. Now, there's something that we need to understand about this, and that is explained in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the great resurrection chapter. In verse 52, Rabbi Shaul or Paul wrote this: "It will take but a moment, the blink of an eye, at the final shofar. For the shofar will sound, and the dead will be raised to live forever, and we too will be changed." That is, the people who are still alive at that point will be changed. Verse 43, "For this material, which can decay," he's talking about his body, "must be clothed with imperishability. This which is mortal must be clothed with immortality." So what's going to happen in this blink of an eye? We're going to get new bodies. You understand that? And they will not be like these bodies that are aging. They will be like bodies that are immortal. Just like Yeshua's body when he rose up. So we will be able to rise. We'll see where it speaks about that later, about us rising on that day. Actually, it talks about here. We'll be changed, and we will rise up with him to meet him in the air. Now, I know that some churches celebrate this day, the 40th day. Jewish people certainly don't celebrate it, but I'm starting a new tradition. I'm celebrating it, and I'm encouraging you to celebrate it, because it is an awesome day. It's a big thing that happened, that Yeshua rose in this way. And to get just a feeling of how amazing this was, just try to imagine the disciples' shock and amazement when he lifted off the ground and disappeared into the clouds. In the book of Acts, it continues to describe that, and it's kind of low key, because it says, verse 10, "As they were staring into the sky after him," so I read in that they were like, mouth open, like, what just happened? We saw he was crucified, he rose from the dead, he had a new body, and now he's been with us for 40 days, and all of a sudden he rises in the air and disappears, and they're just in shock. And then verse 11, the rest of verse 10, "Suddenly they saw two men dressed in white standing next to them." In verse 11, the men said, "You Galileans, why are you standing staring into space?" They were still staring into space. "This Yeshua, who has been taken away from you into heaven, will come back to you in just the same way as you saw him go into heaven." You say hallelujah. Hallelujah. He will come back. This is a prediction of his return out of the clouds and to reign as king for 1,000 years, which I alluded to praying earlier as a worship closed out. And he'll come back that way, but the amazing thing, as we'll see, is he came back in another way also. Verse 12, "Then they returned the Shabbat walk distance from the Mount of Olives to Yerushalayim. And after entering the city," verse 13, "they went to the upstairs room where they were staying." So they obeyed Yeshua's instruction. But now, just try to wrap your head around how difficult those next 10 days would have been for them. After 3 years of being with Yeshua in his human body, seeing him do all of these miracles and healings and multiplying food, and then all of a sudden he's with them in his glorified body for 40 days, teaching them, as the word says, speaking to them, eating with them, and then all of a sudden he's gone. He's gone. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? I mean, his glory, his glorified body must have been awesome to be with all of those 10 days. It's like being in the Holy of Holies with the glory of the Lord appearing there. Here he is standing right next to you. And then he's gone. He's gone. That presence was so powerful that Moses couldn't even enter the tabernacle, and the priest couldn't enter Solomon's temple. And then he's gone. Life's going to be really, really different. And they had no clue what was going to happen next. He's gone. So I think there's something I never saw before. This was a period of great trial for the disciples as they struggled with, well, what do we do? What are we going to do? And actually, verse 14 tells us what they did. And you can understand why they did it. Verse 14 says, these all devoted themselves single-mindedly to prayer, along with the women, some women, including Miriam, Yeshua's mother, and his brothers. So what did they do? They didn't know what to do, so they prayed. They began to pray. Now, the thing is that soon Yeshua would return in a new way. Not his coming return as a ruling king, but his return as the Ruach HaKodesh, filling his disciples as the Holy Spirit, dwelling inside them, and later dwelling inside you and I, his followers. So, in addition to the world, the church, not celebrating Yeshua's ascension, I don't think there's an appropriate awe of how amazing it is that God would put his Holy Spirit in you and I and dwell there. We just kind of, you know, oh, this is a great experience. Like Catherine was saying, when that day she was filled with the Holy Spirit, and that was great that you had that awe. But I think many people are just like, oh, yeah, I got filled with the Holy Spirit. Yeah, it was years ago. Wonderful, great. But it is just such an amazing thing. And I believe the Lord wants to help you understand the awesomeness, the amazingness of his presence dwelling in you by going back and looking at all the things that had to be done for God's presence to dwell in the tabernacle and in the temple. So let's look at that. And we'll start out with the Israelites leaving Egypt, crossing the Red Sea, seeing the Egyptians destroyed by the water of the Red Sea, coming to Mount Sinai. And when they were walking there, they were led by God as a pillar of fire and a pillar of cloud. And then they saw God come down on Mount Sinai as a fire. And they heard God. They heard him speak the Ten Commandments. Now, we're talking about the entire nation of Israel, about at least 3 million people. And then Moses went up on Mount Sinai to be with God. And he was there 40 days. I think I've got a picture of Mount Sinai here with the fire on top of it. And in Exodus 32, while he was away, the Israelites built a golden calf, and they worshiped it as the God who brought them out of Egypt. They actually said that. This is our God that brought us out of Egypt. Can you imagine how heartbroken and painful that was for God to hear them saying, well, these golden things that we made, this calf, this is what brought us out of Egypt. When he had done the 10 plagues, when he parted the waters, when he brought the waters back, and then he was the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud. No, it's this golden calf. This led us out of Egypt. So God was so angry that he says to Moses, I'm going to destroy them all and start over with you. I'm going to start with your family. But Moses interceded for the people. And I give Moses a lot of credit for this. For the people had been a real problem for him. They had not been nice to him. And yet he interceded for the people. And he came down. And, oh, I'm sorry, he interceded for the people. In chapter 32, verse 14 of Exodus, we read this. So Adonai relented from the destruction that he said he would do to his people. And then Moses came down. He destroyed the idol. He confronted the people with their sin. 3,000 who had committed this idolatry died that day. And then the drama wasn't over, because God said to Moses in chapter 33 and verse 3, he said, head up into the land flowing with milk and honey, the promised land. But I will not move within the midst of you, so that I do not destroy you along the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. So this is a very important point to grasp. As a result of the idolatry, God said, I won't move in the midst of Israel, because they were stiff-necked. Now, I looked up the words to this. The word destroy is annihilate, consume, bring to an end, exterminate. That's what would happen if he went in the midst of the people. And then stiff-necked is obstinate, stubborn, hard. So why? Why could God not go in the midst? Well, it's because God is kadosh. He is holy. And he cannot be in the presence of evil without it being consumed. His manifest presence, like the pillar of cloud or fire, would have consumed all evil that was near it. And we get this from one of the prophets in the Old Testament, Habakkuk, chapter 1 and verse 13. He says, speaking of God, he says, with eyes too pure to see evil, you cannot look at such trouble. So the way we understand is that evil cannot come into the presence of God. Now this should give you all a good godly fear of the Lord. And it's important to understand that, you know, we have this understanding that God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. So I used a couple of words there that I need to explain because they're very important to understand. I used the word manifest presence. And when I say that, what I mean is that the presence of God that you can see or feel with your human senses, not just knowing that God is everywhere, but a tangible presence of God like the pillar of cloud and fire, like the Israelites in their tents in the desert, they woke up in the morning, crawled out of the tent, there was God. Pillar of cloud, right before them. And of course, he's manifested in many other times and ways. He manifested himself to Moses as the burning bush. But that's what I'm talking about. Yeshua was a manifestation of the presence of God. So then we read this in Exodus 33. Now, Moses used to take the tent and pitch it outside the camp, far off from the camp. And he called it the tent of meeting. So it happened that everyone who saw Adonai would go out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp. And I've got a picture here. It's not a real good one of the tent. There on the right-hand side is the pillar of fire, but the tent of Moses is behind it. Now, this is, again, important to understand. This was not the tabernacle that Moses built. It was a tent far off from the camp. And God manifested his presence. There's the fire as the pillar of fire and cloud. Not in the midst of the camp of Israel, but far off from the camp. So here we see this same dynamic or understanding that God could not come in a manifest presence into the midst of Israel or the people would be consumed. Everybody got that? So he was meeting with Moses outside the camp. But Moses interceded again, and God made a way for his manifest presence to dwell in the midst of the stiff-necked people of Israel without consuming them. And now, here's where you see how much of a big deal this is. He told Moses to make a tabernacle with a courtyard. He commanded sacrifices, anointing oil to make the space holy. He appointed Kohanim, or priests, to do the work of consecrating that tabernacle, keeping it holy. And then he appointed a day called Yom Kippur, to do atoning sacrifices, covering all the sin of Israel for an entire year. And with all of those provisions, God could come in the midst of the people of Israel. That's how much had to go on. And that tabernacle was the tent of meeting that Moses built was not that little tent. The tabernacle was a copy of the throne room in heaven. I think I may have some more pictures in a little bit of that. And in Numbers chapter 2 and verse 2, we find out that he indeed dwelt in the midst of that. It says, let each man encamp under his own standard among the banners of their ancestral houses at an appropriate distance around the tent of meeting, around the tabernacle, where the presence of God would dwell in the midst of the camp of Israel. And then in Exodus 40, the last chapter, verse 34, then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of Adonai filled the tabernacle. I've got a picture of that. This is the artist's conception based on the instructions to Moses of what that tabernacle actually looked like. And you can see the cloud. The cloud has come down. The cloud on the right-hand side is where they had the altar of burnt offering. So there was smoke going up. But the cloud over the back of the tabernacle, that's over the Holy of Holies. In verse 35, Moses was unable to enter into the tent of meeting because the cloud residing there and the glory of Adonai filled the tabernacle. So Moses couldn't even get in there. And the tabernacle was in the midst of the camp of Israel now, not outside or far off. And what I believe the Lord wanted us all to grasp here was that the move from outside, from far off, into the middle of the camp was really a significant thing. So the God was now in the midst of a stiff-necked people without consuming them, and all of those things had to be done. I think it took about a year to build that tabernacle. All of that had to be done to enable that. And the pillar of fire were over the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was and the mercy seat. And they were there in the midst of the people in the desert for 40 years, traveling around. It was portable, so it traveled. And here's a picture of the courtyard around the tabernacle. And then as we read about the taking of the promised land, the tabernacle was put up at a place called Shiloh, which is still a great place to visit in Israel. But it's interesting that there is no mention of the pillar of cloud in the book of Joshua, in the book of Judges, in the book of Samuel, even though it does talk about the Ark of the Covenant having tremendous power, because there was one point where the Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines, and all sorts of terrible things started happening until they gave it back. So there was still power there, but there's no record of the cloud showing up. And then 300 years later, God showed King David it was time to replace the portable tabernacle with a temple of wood and stone. And he showed David exactly where to build that temple. David made the plans, gathered the materials, and his son Solomon built the temple. And once again, when Solomon dedicated that temple, the same miraculous manifestation of God's presence happened. In 1 Kings chapter 8 and verse 10, it says this: "Now when the Kohanim, the priests, came out of the holy place, the cloud filled the house of Adonai." And I think I've got another picture of that. This is a model of the temple in Jerusalem with the cloud over it. In verse 11, "So that the Kohanim could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of Adonai filled the house of Adonai." So what did it mean to Israel that the Lord would dwell in the tabernacle or in the temple in the midst of Israel? Well, there was ultimate security. Nobody was going to attack Israel with the Lord dwelling there. There was provision, rain for the crops. There was protection from plagues, from locusts. There was direction for the government. There was justice. There was peace. There was security. And Solomon's temple lasted for 470 years. And then, just before its destruction by the Babylonians in the year 587 BCE, Ezekiel, the prophet, saw God's presence leave the temple because of Israel's sin. In Ezekiel 11, verse 23, it says this: "The glory of Adonai went up from within the city and then stood still on the mountains," that is to the east of the city. Now, the Babylonians would not have been able to destroy the temple if God's glory had still been there. Then there's no record of God's presence coming back when the temple was rebuilt, which is recorded in Ezra and Nehemiah, and no record of God's presence in the book of Maccabees. But before the Babylonian destruction, the prophet Malachi predicted that the manifest presence of God would return. And this is so beautiful. Just listen to how he would return. Malachi 3:1, "Behold, I am sending my messenger. He will clear the way before me. Suddenly he will come to his temple, the Lord whom you seek, and the messenger of the covenant, the one whom you desire. Behold, he is coming, says Adonai, Tzvaot, the Lord of hosts." Who is the messenger of the covenant? Who is the Lord whom you desire? It's Yeshua. He's predicting Yeshua coming. The glory of the Lord was not there. The pillar of fire and cloud was not there. But the glory of the Lord was coming. The manifest presence of the Lord was going to come into that temple. Now, some people immediately think, oh, must have been like when he cleansed the temple, according to the book of John. No. Maybe it was his circumcision. No, circumcisions were done in homes. According to Luke chapter 2 and Leviticus 12, it was when he was 33 days old and his parents brought him to the temple for what's called his pidyon haben, the redemption of the firstborn. He was a firstborn son. So every firstborn Jewish son has this ceremony where the firstborns belong to the Lord and the parents redeem him. They bring him back to belong to them. This is what happened with Samuel. Samuel was Hannah's firstborn son, and she gave him to the Lord. She never redeemed him, so he served in the temple. So Yeshua was brought to the temple to be redeemed by his parents when he was 33 days old. And here's the really cool thing. Yeshua was God's manifest presence, right? Everybody understands that. But he didn't stay in the temple. Instead, God's presence filled Yeshua as he traveled wherever he went. And he manifested God's presence not by having a cloud over his head or a pillar of fire over his head, but how? Miracles, healings, deliverances, wisdom that he spoke, revelations, resurrections, calming the storm, inspired teachings, the transfiguration on top of the mountain, words of knowledge that he had. So that was the Lord returning to his temple, and then the temple being basically his body, and his body walking around with the glory of the Lord being in him. But then, just before he died and rose, he said something really shocking. You ready to be shocked? It is shocking. John 16, verse 7, speaking to his disciples who had been with him for 3 years. "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away." What? What? It's your advantage? "For if I don't go away, the comforting counselor will not come to you. However, if I do go, I will send him to you." The comforting counselor is the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. Do you see how shocking this statement would have been to his disciples? "No, we want you. You stay here, please. We've been with you for 3 years. How can we do without you?" But Yeshua is saying, it's going to be better for you that this Holy Spirit comes to you. It is to your advantage. It's better than having Yeshua standing right here. I mean, I still can't conceive that. Can you imagine Yeshua standing right here and saying to you, "I'm going, but it's better for you. Give me a break. How could that be better?" But he says it's better, so we have to believe him that it is better. Now, one reason it's to our advantage that he has descended is given to us in Romans chapter 8. Verse 34. "It is Messiah who died and moreover was raised and is now at the right hand of God and who also intercedes for us." So he's interceding for everybody who's here, everybody who's watching online, everybody who believes in him in the whole world. Now, he couldn't do that if he was here in that human form, right? Because he was in human form. So that's one of the advantages. And I don't know about you, anybody else here thankful that he's interceding for you right now? Yeah, because I believe someday we'll get to heaven and we'll find out how many times his intercession saved us from disasters, saved me from getting myself into some big trouble because he's interceding for me. And he also gave some further understanding of the Holy Spirit who he was sent and why it was so important that each of us would have the Holy Spirit. In John 14, 16, he said, "I will ask the Father, he will give you another helper. He may be with you forever." So he'll never leave. He'll be your helper. And this word helper or counselor is the word parakletos, which in Greek means attorney, lawyer. So this role of the helper is that he helps us understand God's law. That's what an attorney does. And how to live in accordance with his law. And then in verse 17, "The Spirit of truth whom you cannot receive because it does not behold him or know him, because the world does not behold him or know him. You know him because he abides with you and will be in you." So here's another thing. The Holy Spirit is revealing truth to all the people all around the world who have the Holy Spirit. And I believe everybody who receives Yeshua as Messiah has the Holy Spirit dwelling in them. We'll talk about a little later about being filled. But he will dwell in you and reveal truth to you. This is so important. Like if you're listening to somebody teaching like me, it's the Holy Spirit who's revealing to you if I'm telling the truth right now. Okay? Because He also says that the Holy Spirit will glorify him, not the person speaking or some organization or some method or some book. He'll glorify the Messiah. In John 14:20, we find another amazing thing. And again, this is hard to grasp, so everybody get ready. Ready to grasp this?
Yes.
In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Did you get that? I'll say it again. You will know that I, Yeshua, am in my Father. You are in me. Now, if you're in him and he's in the Father, you're in the Father. And I am in you. And that means the Father is in you too. So how would Yeshua, the Holy Spirit, and the Father all be in us? Well, it's really simple. It's only possible because they are one. They are one. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. They are one. God come as a man is Yeshua. God come as a spirit is the Holy Spirit. It's pretty simple. And God the Father is invisible, but he's part of that. And Rabbi Shaul speaks of this also in the book of Colossians, in chapter 1 and verse 27. God chose to make known to them this glorious mystery regarding the Gentiles, which is Messiah in you, the hope of glory. And that's why I thank Catherine for all those songs about glory today. The hope of glory. So what is the glorious mystery? The Messiah in the Gentiles, dwelling in you as the Ruach HaKodesh. And in praying to the Father, Yeshua said this, another one of these things about it is hard to grasp. I in them and you in me. He's praying to the Father. That they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them, and this is hard to grasp, as you loved me. That means God loves you like he loved Yeshua. Amazing. So if Yeshua is in you and the Father is in Yeshua, where is the Father? He's in us, because he's one. The Spirit is in us, he's one. They're all in you. Because they're one. So this indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the indwelling till the overflowing, happened on Shavuot, on the 50th day. Acts chapter 2, we're going back to in verse 4, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And I've looked this up, the word filled there means filled to the overflowing. So that so much of the Holy Spirit is in you that it flows out to other people. Now, there were great leaders and prophets in the Tanakh, like Moses and Isaiah and David. The Holy Spirit was on them, but this overflowing, this filling, and this filling in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Shavuot, it was a fulfillment of a prophecy of Joel, another prophet in the Tanakh. Chapter 3 and verse 1. So it will be afterwards. I will pour out my Ruach on all flesh. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. In verse 2, also on the male and female servants will I pour out my Spirit in those days. So what he's saying is here that the Holy Spirit will be poured out and dwell on all the people who are followers of Yeshua. But here's the big but. That I hope some of you have wondered about, because this is so important to understand. How can the Holy God dwell in me and in you without consuming us? Like he would have consumed the Israelites. I've been stiff-necked. I've fallen short of God's standards. Anybody else here honest enough to admit that you've disobeyed him at times? You've been stiff-necked at times? I still have my old nature, my flesh. Anybody else? Still have a carnal nature. I still struggle with what the rabbis call the Yetzer Ra, the evil inclination that tempts us. So I still struggle with the temptations of the devil. So God made a way to deal with Israel's sin, transgression, and iniquity so he could dwell in the midst of his people in the temple. And in the instruction for the high priest for Yom Kippur, he speaks of one of the sacrifice animals called the scapegoat. And in Leviticus 16, verse 21, we read this. Aaron should lay both his hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the iniquities of Bnei Israel, the sons of Israel, and all their transgressions and all their sins. He should place them on the head of the goat and send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a man who is in readiness. Verse 22, the goat will carry all their iniquities by itself into a solitary land, and he's to leave the goat in the wilderness. So this Yom Kippur scapegoat bore the sins, the transgressions, the iniquity of all the people of Israel away into the desert. That's why God's manifest presence could dwell in their midst in the temple in Jerusalem for another year. And then it had to be renewed every year. They had to redo that every year for God's presence to dwell in their midst. So the prophet Isaiah, who was familiar with all this, speaks about a prediction of the Messiah in chapter 53, verse 5. But he, the Messiah, was pierced because of our transgressions, crushed because of our iniquities. The chastisement for our shalom is upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. In verse 6, we all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. So Adonai laid on him the iniquity of us all, just like we just read with the scapegoat. The priest put his hands on the goat and confessed the sins of Israel on that goat. In the same way, the Lord laid the iniquity of all people for all time on Yeshua. So Yeshua fulfilled the sacrifices of the scapegoat. And he didn't fulfill them for a year. How long did he fulfill them for? Forever. Forever. And he didn't fulfill them just for the people of Israel. He filled it for everyone who will receive it. And here's another amazing thing. They carried the sins out into the desert. Yeshua didn't cover your sins like the other sacrifices in the temple. It's the word Kippur. They're coverings. But Yeshua didn't cover your sins. He carried them away, fulfilling a promise in the Psalms. Psalms 103, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. He didn't just cover them. He removed them so that he could dwell in you and I as the Ruach HaKodesh. So now let's go back to Colossians. In chapter 1, 27, we read that. But we're going to read through from verse 25 now, just to see the context. Paul is saying about himself, I became its servant, the gospel servant, according to God's commission, given to me for you, in order to declare his message in full. Verse 26, the mystery that was hidden for ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his kedoshim, to his saints, to his believers. Verse 27, God chose to make known to them this glorious mystery regarding the Gentiles, which is Messiah in you, the hope of glory. Now, why does Paul say that it's the big thing of the mystery was that the Messiah being in the Gentiles as well as the Jews? God says it was so important to declare this mystery that that's his commission. This is what he's called to do. And the reason is because think of the culture in that day. You had the Jewish people, they had the Torah, the laws of Moses, the temple. They weren't perfect by any means, but they were trying to obey God's commandments. They were trying to keep ritually pure so that God, they could go to the temple and they could worship, all of those things. So that was what was happening in Israel. But the Gentiles, they didn't even know what the Torah was. They were pagans. They were worshiping idols. If we look back at that time of the gods of Rome and the gods of Greek, they have all of these myths of who these gods were. They were unclean. They were idolaters. So it was radical that Messianic Jews could have the Spirit of God living in them. But the promise of living in the Gentiles, the Messianic Jews couldn't even handle that. That's impossible. How could that be? Yet Yeshua's sacrifice was so powerful that enabled them to dwell in people who had no previous knowledge of God's law. They were told about the Messiah, will take away your sins, give your lives to him, repent, and boom, he's in them. Amazing. Amazing. And then Rabbi Scholl says that this is your hope of glory. Your hope of glory. Now, I want to explain that, because Catherine talked about the glory of the Lord, the kavod falling upon your heaven. There's two meanings. I've talked about this recently, so bear with me. There's two meanings to the word glory. And one of them is what Catherine was talking about, the glory of the Lord. It's the Hebrew is kavod. His glory being in the temple, meaning his manifest presence, a physical manifestation that you can see, doing miracles, that's a manifestation of God's presence. Healings, that's a manifestation of God's presence. The 10 plagues were a manifestation of God's presence, okay? But there's a second meaning to the word glory in English. In Exodus chapter 4, Moses asked God to show him his glory. And it's surprising what God did. God said, this is my glory, it's my goodness, my love, my mercy, my patience, and my justice. So the second meaning of glory is that for which a person is esteemed or honored, their goodness. So Messiah in you, the hope of glory, doesn't mean you're going to have a pillar of fire over your head. And doesn't necessarily mean you're going to do things that are supernatural, although that's part of it. But mainly it means that you will be a person worthy of esteem. So we would say, you know, like somebody who did some great thing, like let's say Billy Graham, he was worthy of our esteem because he led so many people to the Lord. So that was his glory. That's his glory, that he did those things and he led those people. So this is that second meaning. So the Messiah in you, the hope of glory, means that your hope of glory is your hope of accomplishing or being a person worthy of esteem. And that's a good thing to be. It's not, you know, pride or something like that, because it's esteem from God. So it's your hope of fulfilling your destiny, taking your promised land, which is accomplishing all God wants you to accomplish and becoming all God wants you to accomplish, pleasing God. And what is your hope and glory? Did you catch it? It's in the verse. Messiah in you. You would have no hope of glory if Messiah was not in you. You see how significant that is? Because it's only him in you that can bring out things that are worthy, things that are true, things that are good in God's eyes. So him being in you, that's your hope of glory. And then in Romans 8, Rabbi Scholl expands on this, verse 29, because those whom he knew in advance, that's whom he predestined to become his children, he also determined in advance would be conformed to the pattern or the image of his son, so that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. In verse 30, and those whom he thus determined in advance, he also called, and those whom he called, he also caused to be considered righteous in right standing with God, and those whom he caused to be considered righteous, he also glorified. Yeah, you can clap. He's glorified you. God's plan for you is that because the Holy Spirit is in you, he will conform you to the image of Yeshua, meaning you will become more and more like Yeshua in character. And as you do, that will be your glory. This is what I should be esteemed for, being like Yeshua, right? And it doesn't mean you're going to look like Yeshua, not at all. It's going to be that you're going to have the character of Yeshua. And I think of the words of a song by Jonas Myron. It's called a song called Unbroken Praise. And he's got a line in there that says this: let my deeds outrun my words. Let my life outweigh my songs. In other words, let who I am be more than what I have accomplished. So it's a good thing to want to have glory in the sense. Everybody see that? Because the enemy's going to say, oh, that's just pride. No, that's not a bad thing. It's not ungodly ambition. The kind of glory that comes from Messiah being in us, it's really his glory. So now, I'm going to give you a little bit of homework. The Holy Spirit is going to give you homework to think about. What's the difference between God being present, watching you, and being in you? Think about that for a minute. Well, when he's present, he sees all you do, right? And that should give you some fear of the Lord, right? But when he's in you, what is it like? What is it like? He knows you. He knows all your thoughts. Read Psalm 139, where David says, I can't get away, because wherever I go, you're there. You know my sitting down, my standing up, you know all my thoughts. He knows your godly thoughts. Wonderful. He knows your ungodly thoughts and my ungodly thoughts. Now here's another thing. He feels what you feel, because he's in you. He feels your pain. He feels your bitterness. He feels your joy. That's good. He feels the exertion when you're struggling. And his power is in you to guide you and enable you to do his will. So, here's the bottom line. See how many of you got it. Where is the manifest presence of God today? Right here. In us. In us. In everyone whom the Holy Spirit is dwelling in. And remember that definition. It's not something you can see or feel. It's something you can see or feel with human senses. Not just knowing God is everywhere, but a tangible presence like the pillar of cloud and fire. So how is it? It's when you do things and say things and act in ways that are godly that God's manifest presence is here on this earth. It's here so that others can see or feel with our human senses God is here because you did something for them. You showed them God's love. You spoke the truth to them. We, you and I, are how God makes himself known to people on earth. Right? I mean, there's no other way. Through your good deeds and your godly character, that's how God manifests on earth. And what is your godly character? Well, we can read it right out of Galatians 5. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, self-control. That's the character of Yeshua. And as you demonstrate that character, as you become that character, that's how the world knows God. That's what God is like. And all of that is your glory. So here's some questions to pray through this week. Okay. How often have you been conscious of God's presence in you? Not his presence in the sanctuary or in worship or in the beauty of creation, but his presence in you. How often? How often? On the day of your salvation, when you're in an anointed worship service, when you have devotions, how about today? Are you aware of God's presence in you right now? Just take a minute and close your eyes. Where are you, God? Where are you? Anybody get an answer? Where is he? He's in me. He's in me. Yes, yes. Do you think God will only allow you to be aware of his presence in special times? No, that's not true. John 14, verse 20 says, in that day, you will know that I am in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. What day? In that day. In the day that he sends the Holy Spirit. And of course, it doesn't mean just that day. It means all succeeding days, right? That you would know. And Yeshua was praying this to the Father, that we may know he is in us. So I think his prayers get answered Right? Right? He wants you to be aware of his dwelling in us. So I hope you got it. Here's another answer to the message that Pastor Tom did. Where's God? In me. In you. Where's Yeshua? Where's the Ruach? In us. Because they're one. How long will they be there? Forever. Even though you're going to get a new glorified body, they will be there. They will be there. It's mind-boggling. Our human minds have a hard time grasping it. Now understand that he's a spirit. That's why he can be in you and in me and in believers all around the world. He's in somebody in India right now. Right? It's not the Lord that's keeping you from the awareness of his presence. What is it? Unbelief? Busyness? Some people are afraid that God would be in them because they know that there's some negative stuff in there. That's okay. He already knows it. Or other priorities in your life that make you unaware. Now, here's another one to try this week. When you are praying to God, do you pray to God in heaven or do you pray to God in you? Think about that one this week when you go to pray. So let's pray together now to God within us. Okay, thank you, Father, for manifesting ourselves to your forefathers as a pillar of cloud and fire. Thank you for making a way that you could dwell in the midst of the people of Israel, not consume them. Thank you for providing atonement for them through the sacrifices and manifesting yourself over the tabernacle and the temple. And thank you for manifesting yourself as the Messiah, coming to the temple, manifesting your glory by healing, delivering, resurrecting, teaching, revealing. Thank you, Lord, most of all, for sacrificing your sinless life to make atonement for us. Not just to cover our sins, but to remove them. How far? As far as the east is from the west. That's infinity. Move them as far as the east is from the... Thank you. Thank you for going, ascending, leaving, and sending your Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit who will dwell in us, who's dwelling in us now, who will never leave us. And help us to understand this mystery that because your Spirit is in us, the Father and the Son are also in us because you're one. Right now, we repent of unbelief of this. We repent of not believing that you dwell in us. Forgive us. We believe your word that says you do. And so I pray for each of us who is hearing this, that during the next few days, you would make us aware of your presence in us. In us. And that you would enable us to live as people who know that you're in us. And then... You say this, Lord, that you're glorifying us by enabling us to fulfill our destinies, take our promised land, accomplish all that you have for us, and become all that you want us to be. And help us to understand that you dwelling in us is our hope of glory. And then, Lord, along with that song, may our deeds outlive our words. And may our lives outweigh our songs. And we thank you for the honor, the privilege of being your manifest presence on earth. It's hard to grasp. Thank you for making us your manifest presence on earth. May we live up to the responsibility of that incredible role by the power of your Spirit guiding us in the awesome name of Yeshua. Amen.